Good day, I'm Norman Wabiger. This is going to be our last video for 2015, and I think we've accomplished quite a lot, but there's still a lot more to do in 2016. It's appropriate that I end the year with this sort of final video in this little series on these four different types of data structures that we've been talking about. LOMs, standing for lists, ordered sets, multisets, and sets. And today's lecture will be about the final data structure, the most familiar one to most of us, that of a set. So a lot of what we're going to be doing today will be quite familiar to you. So I remind you that a list is something like this. Our convention is square brackets and commas. An ordered set, we have braces and commas representing the fact that it's still ordered. Multiset, square brackets without commas. And our convention for a set is that it's braces, representing the fact that repetitions are not allowed, and no commas, telling us that rearrangements are allowed. So this, for example, is an element of set 5-3, which means that it's a 3-set from 5. All the elements are chosen from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and there are, in this case, 3 elements, so it's a 3-set. So in general, our convention is that a k-set from n is an unordered collection of numbers in the range 1, 2, up to n, without repetitions, and with altogether k numbers. And this gives us a type of object that we'll denote by set nk. So the objects are all from the numbers 1 through n, and there are k of them in the set. And our convention is to use braces and no commas. So that's quite a difference from the usual convention, but it fits well with this kind of framework, and I think it's more natural notationally. Now, because we like to be specific and lay things out with lots of examples so that everybody knows what exactly we're talking about, let's have a look at sets from 5, where we're talking about k sets, k ranging from the full range from 0 to 5. Those are the only possibilities for n equals 5 because repetitions are not allowed. So, set 5, 0. We're talking about 0 sets from 5. There's only one of those, that's the empty set. When k is 1, then there are 5 1 sets. Set 1, the set 2, the set 3, the set 4, and the set 5. When k is 2, there are 10 of these 2 sets from 5. The set 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 2, 3, 2, 4, 2, 5, 3, 4, 3, 5, 4, 5. And notice that we're trying to lay them out in a somewhat systematic fashion, so you can see the pattern that I start with the simplest, smallest values, and then I increment the last one, a lot like the odometer on a car, and once it gets up to its maximum value, then we roll over and go to the next value for the next leftmost entry, so the 1 goes to a 2, and otherwise we start with the smallest values and work their way up again. When k equals 3, we're talking about 3 sets, so looking at triples of numbers from 1 through 5, we have 1, 2, 3, and then again proceeding in this sort of odometer fashion, 1, 2, 4, 1, 2, 5, then we roll over 1, 3, 4, because that's sort of the smallest one that has a 1 and a 3, and then 1, 3, 5, then 1, 4, 5, and then 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 5, 2, 4, 5, and 3, 4, 5. And you probably won't be too surprised to see that there are also 10 of those. In fact, there's a kind of correspondence between the 10 here and the 10 here, right? Because for any one of these, say 2, 3, 5, there's an associated one up here, which is just the other two numbers, in this case 1, 4. So there's a sort of a pairing between this one and this one. Some kind of symmetry here. And similarly, when we go to k equals 4, well, there's going to be 5 of them corresponding sort of to the 5 that we had at the k equals 1 level. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 5, 1, 2, 4, 5, 1, 3, 4, 5, and 2, 3, 4, 5. Missing a 5 here, and then missing a 4, missing a 3, missing a 2, missing a 1. So there's a natural correspondence between these ones and these ones here. And finally, k equals 5, talking about the full set 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And that's actually corresponding with our empty set when k equals 0. So it's a very nice structure, a very important kind of structure. These objects occur in many different places, especially in algebra and the binomial theorem, of course. But it's a very rich theory of sets, just in this very finite, specific, concrete case. So a little bit more notation and conventions. We may as well introduce this type set N, which refers to all the sets from N. In other words, the K-sets, where K can range from 0 all the way up to N. We have, obviously, the notion of the size of a set. So if A is a K-set from N, then the size of A, by definition, is K. That's the size of the set. So, for example, the size of this set here, 4, 2, 1, is, of course, 3. The size of the empty set is 0. Very important is this idea of subsets. So let's say we have two sets A and B, which are both sets from N. Then we'll say that A is a subset of B, and we'll write it like this. That means that if L is an element of A, then L is an element of B. And this little epsilon kind of symbol means L is an element of A. Now you'll be familiar with me writing something like this with a little extended epsilon. I like to use that when I'm referring to something having a certain type. Okay, it's very similar to this, but this is an honest element containment where we're talking about sets. Here our sets are much more constrained than sort of the types that we're always considering. So this is a type, it's not a set. Okay, so I don't want to use this symbol when I'm talking about something like this. I would use the same kind of thing, but with a variant where the little middle bar extends to the left, making it a little bit different. So we have the notion of subset, and I think it's probably a good idea if we are specific about the usage of this particular symbol. In many situations, these two symbols are pretty well the same. But there's some argument to be made that that's a little bit unnecessary. Why have two symbols that mean the same thing? And because this subset symbol is naturally corresponding to the less than or equal symbol at the level of multiplicities, right? The multiplicities of elements in sets are always either 0 or 1. And this subset relation, just as it is in the multiset case, is really corresponding to the fact that the multiplicity of any element in here is less than or equal to the multiplicity of the corresponding element in there. So we can reserve this symbol for A being a subset of B, but not actually equal to B. We might say a proper subset. That means at least one element of B is not in A. All right, so that's a very important idea of a subset of a set. Interestingly, the subsets of sets have very interesting structure, and this generates a lot of the interest and structure and sort of theory of sets. This picture here shows you the kind of subset structure that I'm talking about that's so important in set theory. So here's a very simple situation where we're only talking about set 3, so sets from 3. And in this case, there's one empty set, there's 3 1 sets, there are 3 2 sets, and 1 3 set. And what we see here is the containment relations that are determined by this notion of a subset. So the empty set is a subset of 1, 2, and 3. And 1, 2, and 3 are all subsets of some of these. So 1 and 2 are subsets of this one, 1 and 3 are subsets of this one, and 2 and 3 are subsets of this one. That's why we have these lines here representing the subset kind of relation. And then all of these are subsets of this one. So this is what's officially called a poset, or partially ordered set, and that's something that we will have to talk about in the future. So we'll lay out that later on, but I'm just flagging it here. It's a very interesting additional structure that you get sort of for free once you start looking at sets. You can see in this particular case, when n equals 3, that this diagram has almost a three-dimensional aspect. It sort of looks like a cube, sort of flattened out onto the plane. It's kind of pleasant. And there's a symmetry, the same kind of symmetry that we've remarked on before, between sort of this level and this level, between this level and this level. And of course, the numbers on each level, k equals 0, k equals 1, k equals 2, k equals 3 levels, these are just the binomial coefficients, 1, 3, 3, 1. That's not an accident, of course. So it's instructive and interesting to see what the corresponding sort of posets are for a little bit bigger values. So I'll leave it to you as an exercise to draw a similar kind of picture for set 4. Okay? See if you can make a nice picture that looks like this one, but with a bit more sets involved. So it will turn out that for larger values, that this structure is really the source of all kinds of interesting combinatorial questions and results, and it's really a core object in combinatorics. There are, of course, a lot of parallels between sets and multisets. And in some ways, we can think of sets as being just special cases of multisets where the multiplicities are all either 0 or 1. But technically speaking, it's probably better for us if we keep these different data structures, at least officially, separate. Nevertheless, we can talk about the relationship between sets and msets by a device something like this. So if A is a set from N, we can associate to it a multiset A sub M from mset of N just by replacing the braces in A with square brackets. So for example, if A is the set 4, 2, 1, which is a set from 5, then by replacing the braces with brackets, we get A sub M, which is the mset 4, 2, 1, an mset from 5. So in this way, we can associate very directly an mset for every set. And that means that our various understandings and intuitions, in fact, operations on msets, some of them will apply to sets. But not all of them, because our algebra of msets is considerably richer than the corresponding theory for sets. That's a big advantage in dealing with msets rather than just sets. So it is tempting to consider sets as just special kinds of msets, but probably we should keep the two notions separate, at least officially. Like a computer that wants to distinguish the type this with the type of that. But nevertheless, quite a few ideas from msets apply directly to sets. Of course, not all. In particular, the notions of unions and intersections are pretty well exactly as they are for multisets. So for example, if we have the set 1, 2, we want to take the union with the set 1, 3, 4. Then basically we look at all of the elements and take the union of the multiplicities of each element, which is just the max. And this turns out to be 1, 2, 3, 4. So there's the union. While the intersection means that we're looking at each of the elements and taking the intersection of the various multiplicities, which is the minimum, and that's then just a single one there for the intersection. And just as for msets, we have the kind of distributive laws that relate unions and intersections, or intersections and unions. And of course, we also have the corresponding one where we interchange the places where the brackets are. We have these kind of absorption laws, the role of the empty set, which also is often written with a phi instead of these empty braces, naturally gives rise to these two simple laws, that A union the empty set is A, and A intersect the empty set is the empty set. So at this point, our set theory is very restrictive, because we're only talking about very specific sets built from natural numbers whose sizes are bounded in a very precise way. Later on, we will be enlarging our point of view, but we're going to be doing this in a way that's taking the four different types of data structures, LOMs, lists, ordered sets, msets, and sets, in a kind of a balanced way. So we're going to be extending all of them, and in fact, we're going to be starting to mix these different types of sets eventually, as well as enlarging the kinds of objects that can be inside these data structures. The obvious thing being that once we have data structures as well-defined objects that we're considering, we can use them as ingredients or elements of more sophisticated data structures. It's a very simple and natural way of building up rather elaborate hierarchies of complicated data structures. And there's all kinds of interesting questions associated with that. So very good, we've covered sets, at least a rudimentary kind of introduction to sets. We're going to be now looking at set theory in the modern pure mathematics in a rather critical way in 2016. So I am going to have to be rather merciless in being honest and critical of the very sad logical structure that modern pure mathematics is in with regard to set theory and the corresponding axiomatics. It really does not work. And I'm going to show you explicitly why. And you're going to see why mathematicians actually spend a lot of effort avoiding that entire issue. No one talks about it too much. Officially, there are these almost religious frameworks that we officially agree to, but nobody actually looks at them that carefully, except for sort of the set theorists themselves. Unfortunately, when we do look carefully at the axiomatics, they all start to appear very imprecise and, in fact, arbitrary, and the logic just isn't there. The difficulties that set theory had more than 100 years ago with the discovery of fundamental paradoxes has not really effectively been resolved. That's the main point. And what we have now is really just a bunch of wishful thinking which is pinned up. Okay, so we have to address this. I mean, it's really time that we had a little bit more of an adult approach to things. So 2016, we are going to have a more adult approach to set theory and its difficulties. But I don't want to just be negative. We are also going to be building up rather interesting aspects of this data structure theory. So there's really a very interesting kind of theory out there, but it's more in the combinatorial direction. Okay, and so I want to go a little bit more in that direction in 2016. Let's start there and talk about some interesting counting problems naturally associated with these four different types of data structures. Okay, that will also raise all kinds of interesting questions. And that's how we're going to start 2016 with some counting and combinatorics. I hope you have a great festive season, and I look forward to your company in 2016. Hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wahlberger. Thanks for listening.